we have another excellent speaker, Leland Height, K8CLI. And he's going to be talking about Voice of America.
Is that forward and backwards? Yeah. All right, well, that's being set up. A great big thank you, and we appreciate the invitation to be here this evening on behalf of the museum. The presentation is multi-purpose. I'm going to try and cover all of various aspects of the Voice of America. Thank you. And it's a lot of pictures. I try to minimize the number of words on the screen, so hopefully the pictures will help tell the story. I'm going to go through why the VOA came about, and that's very important, and what actually caused the VOA to come about. A lot of secrets. What were the secrets? We'll talk about that. How did VOA function? Yesterday and today, they're still on the air today. And we'll finish up with a lot of the issues in putting a high-powered broadcast station on the air. It's the same thing you and I do in the amateur radio world. It's just on a little bit bigger scale. So that's, if you've never seen the building, that's where we are down in Westchester, just off I-75. And to begin, let's explain a little bit about the Voice of America. They still exist today. They're on the air, if you will. They're virtual, internet, cellular, satellite. And if you add those five networks together, VOA's audience today is over 15 times larger than those broadcast stations. If you look at the total broadcast station audience, they measure on a weekly basis the same way that the networks measure Voice of America, or measure their listening audience. So it's on a weekly basis. The VOA right now today has a little bit over 410 million listeners on a weekly basis, and the our partner, if you will, VOA and BBC work very closely together. BBC is larger than the Voice of America, has been from the beginning. They're a little bit larger. They have a listening audience that's about 480 million worldwide. So that's what's going on today. If you look at the coverage from the get-go, Voice of America was legislated not to broadcast into the United States. The commercial industry got to the FCC early and legislated that the VOA could not broadcast inside the United States. It had the green areas are the areas of where the target countries were. If you happen to live beside us, you couldn't get rid of us. We were in the hot water heater, or the water heater, the fences, and your stereo, and your telephone, and everything else. But other than that, we were not broadcasting. I want to start with just a little bit of the history and pick up quickly from here. As radio emerged in 1921, the simplest radio was this circuit. There wasn't even a tuning capacitor. It was a diode and a coil, antenna, and ground. And that's what kicked everything off. Paul Crosley in Cincinnati quickly got into the business, and it's because of Crosley in Cincinnati that the Voice of America eventually located in Cincinnati. We were not alone, and we often forget that the rest of the world was developing in parallel, and Germany, Russia, and South America was also developing almost at the same pace. Thank you, Jocelyn. Was developing almost at the same pace. So this development was going on in parallel. And I want to mention that the radio came about and emerged in 1920. We had the crystal radio set in 1921. By 1923, we were well into vacuum tubes. And very early in this game, Germany figured out the strategic value of radio and was early developing transmitters and receivers. Even though they were a little bit crude, they were developing them for their military use. And, excuse me, the first embrace of shortwave radio for strategic reasons was BBC. BBC was a good 10 years ahead of the Voice of America, and that's important as we look at what happens here eventually. They were quick to, in fact, all of Europe was very quick to endorse a shortwave radio. It was the only way that you're going to communicate over long distances, and they developed it very quickly. They're still largest today in the world in terms of broadcast audience. The let's pick up with the point in time when the Nazis took power in Germany in 1933. They tore up the Treaty of Versailles, preventing them from building up their military. And Hitler appointed a communication minister by the name of Joseph Goebbels on the right-hand side of this picture. And he was, in my personal opinion, just plain brilliant. His PhD was in communications. It's not the radio communications that you and I do, but it was in communication psychologically with people. How do you psychologically communicate with them? And he very much influenced what Hitler did. He developed a speaking technique that was very popular and very effective. And his big claim to fame was that he realized that if you're going to have a guns and bullets war, you're going to have to win the hearts and minds of the people. And he figured that out very early. And that's exactly what the propaganda aimed to address, was to go after the psychological value of a military operation. The one thing that they understood probably better than others, well, I'm not going to say they understood it. I think they actually got lucky. Their definition of the frequency spectrum is not what we know it today. They defined the frequency spectrum as long wave, medium wave, and short wave. We all understand medium wave and short wave, but amateur radio doesn't do a lot with long wave. And that roughly defined long wave is 150 kilohertz to 300 kilohertz. And they took that word literally. Long wave must go a long way. So they incorporated that into their radios. When the Nazis took power in Germany, he had an issue. He had to get control of his people. How's he going to do that? Well, we've got this newfangled thing going on called radio. Goes long distance, whoopee-doo. And they had to figure out how to get radios in the hands of the people. Radios at the time cost about $100, $120. So Germany subsidized a radio for the people where they could buy it for about $15. And that's what you're looking at here. It was very insensitive. It was a three-tube radio. There was no RF amplifier on the front end. The antenna went in through a tuning circuit right straight into a detector, and an audio amplifier and a rectifier, and that's all that radio was. Excuse me, it was called the Volksempfanger, the people's radio, like the Volkswagen is called the people's car. You'll notice that little orange tag where that yellow, where the yellow arrow is. You see an orange tag there. On that orange tag was a warning. This is the German version. If you convert it to English, it basically says that if you get caught listening to foreign broadcast, you're going to prison, and typically it was a one-year stay in prison. And that culture, that was shipped with every single radio that they manufactured. And over the course of next 6 years, from 1933 to 39, when World War II started, they put 15 million of those radios in the population of Germany. Hitler had the only shortwave station. He had the only broadcast stations. They were shortwave. No, they weren't shortwave. They were medium wave and long wave. The other thing they did on this radio, I forgot to mention, is they put in medium wave and long wave. It is not a shortwave radio. What, in hindsight, turns out to be brilliant, and I'm not sure they understood what they were doing, is that long wave is not dependent on the outer atmosphere. We don't have to worry about the ionosphere and propagation issues. And that turned out to be a huge benefit later on, as you'll see here. And, excuse me, but also at the same time, most of Europe and that whole region was adopting shortwave and adopting it on a serious method, a serious basis, because that was the only way to really get news and information over a long distance. So everyone was doing it. During this time, he knew he was being effective because he had the only broadcast station. He made the radio. But he had a bit of a problem. We got these fellows here. We've got what they call experimenters. They're buying parts, they're putting radios together, and all of a sudden they learn to build transmitters. Oh my goodness, now they're talking to each other. And uh-oh, they're talking outside the country. And that became an issue. So what happened was they decided they had to get control of those experimenters, and so they confiscated all of their transmitters. Today we call those amateur radio operators, but at that time, in 1933, they confiscated all of the transmitters for the experimenters, and that's one of the ways that Hitler got so many so many transmitters, was that they were already built for him by the amateur radio operators. He dismantled the ham clubs, if you will, and then they got inducted into the military. And if you happened to be a high-speed CW operator, you went to the top of the list. You got better housing, better food, better treatment, because obviously high-speed CW was the way to get effective communications. The rest of the hams, if you will, I'm going to call them hams, they were called experimenters, were inducted into the radio, and they became radio operators, and still got quite good treatment. The other thing that was going on in this time frame, that was 1933, when the Nazis took power in Germany. In 1934, something very important happened here in Cincinnati, and that is Paul Crosley had been manufacturing radios. He manufactured very low-cost radios, and how do you get an effective signal into a low-cost radio? You make a really big transmitter. So by 1934, he had put a 500,000-watt AM broadcast station on the air, and the antenna that you see down there, that diamond-shaped antenna, at the time that it was built, was a 5/8 wave antenna, same reason we build 5/8 waves for VHF and UHF to squish that pattern down and get a good coverage. So he had already accomplished all of the issues of putting a 500,000-watt transmitter on the air. Excuse me. During this time period, from 33 to 39, they made different flavors of this receiver, if you will. The one for the public was just 3-tube, but others in this picture here are 4-tube and 5-tube. The ones that are colored gray are for his military. He wanted to make sure he kept control of his military, and that's a good 5-tube radio, and they put shortwave on the military version. So at this time, pretty much all of Europe and that whole area, the primary method of communication is shortwave. You'll see the shortwave band here on the top scale of this radio, and many of them, as you well know, identified the city of origin. The big wake-up call here starts World War II in 1939, and what happened? Immediately in 1939, if you're a shortwave broadcaster, you're also a shortwave listener. Okay, and so what happens? As soon as he declares war and people get really concerned, how are you going to get information? They started setting up listening stations on a massive scale. This is the BBC listening station. That entire building is full of receivers. The backyard is full of antennas, and they set up a massive listening operation to figure out what was going on inside of Germany. The same happened with others, CBS, NBC, Crosley Broadcasting. Princeton set up a really large listening station, and that intelligence was fed back to the government and also back to the United States. As I mentioned before, this country was legislated not to be in the broadcasting business, and that started very early. So by the time World War II started, we were not, the government was not allowed to be in the broadcast business. So what happened is that they could suggest content. Well, WLW, the Paul Crosley station in Cincinnati, had a shortwave station that he put on the air as early as 1924, had kept building the power up, And by the time of 1939, it was up to a 75,000-watt shortwave transmitter, the largest one in the country. And so the government came in and provided suggested content over the WLWO. It's O for overseas. And they basically leased the transmitters. They also, in all fairness, there was a GE station in San Francisco that was 50 kW, and they also provided suggested content. So at the beginning of World War II, these two stations carried suggested content from the Department of War Information in Washington. There were some other low power units. There were a lot of 10 kW units around, but they were not really all that effective. This is what the world looked like in 1941, just prior to Pearl Harbor. The United States basically had one high power transmitter and one lower power one in San Francisco. And at the same time, Germany had 68 shortwave transmitters. Japan had 42, and I'll talk about Russia in a minute here. They had literally over 1,000. Yeah, doing the broadcasts, and that just will demonstrate how far behind the United States was in trying to do shortwave broadcast. The big wake-up call comes 1941, December, and immediately the government comes in and takes over KGEI in San Francisco. Within 5 days, they put government broadcasting on KGEI, and a few days later, they came in and took over WLWO in Cincinnati, and that became the first Voice of America transmitter to put out the very first message. That was shortwave to BBC, and then BBC put it on longwave and broadcast it around Germany, because we already knew that the Volksempfanger was a longwave, medium wave type radio. So this transmitter played a very important role all the way up until the time of when Crosley could build the high power 200 kW transmitters. I want to switch subjects a little bit here. Almost all shortwave broadcasters used an antenna called the Rhombic. It's a non-resonant diamond-shaped antenna, minimum of two wavelengths in length. VOA used Rhombics exclusively throughout all of their broadcast stations. And what I want to point out here is that the way, as you may already know, you put power in at one end of the rhombic, and you have to take 50% of the power out at the other end of the rhombic. And intellectually, that kind of bothers you, because if you're going to put 100 watts in one end, you're going to take 50 watts out the other. Well, if you're going to put 75,000 watts in, you're taking a whole lot of power out the other end. To you and I, that's 3 dB, and with a good amateur radio receiver, that's probably not going to be a really big deal. But if you don't have an amateur radio receiver and you're listening on a little 5-tube radio, 3 dB might make a really big difference. So what happened was, this is the way almost everyone ran their rhombics. It was to waste 50% of the power at the other end of the antenna. And how that works is that as long as you're doing that, you get this pattern. You get these lobes that are pointing straight forward, and you get a very narrow pattern. You also get rid of that back lobe that's on the back side of a Yagi that way. Excuse me. The engineers at WLW it bothered them that they're going to waste all this power at the far end of a rhombic, so they decided to recover that power. They took the output power, rather than wasting it in a resistor, they put it in a transmission line and fed it back to the input, matched it so it was in phase, and was able to take a 75,000-watt input and create over a 2-megawatt ERP at the end of the antenna. It was highly effective, and was the reason that Hitler called us the Cincinnati Liars, because the signal was so commanding in Germany. This picture, this is the actual rhombic, and it's hard to see in this picture, but you'll see a transmission line going from the far end back to the input. The interesting thing here is when the 200,000-watt transmitters went on the air, they used this same antenna. Well, 200,000 watts into this thing will produce over a 15 megawatt ERP at the end of that antenna. That's going to generate a great deal of power. This is kind of what it looked like. There were a couple of matching stubs near the input that you matched it to the input phase. The result of 15 megawatts of power is that things stopped working. Tractors would stop in the field. Cars would stop. As I mentioned, you're into everybody's stereo, water heater, and all that. The EMP testing was not existent in the United States. No one did EMP testing at this time. So what happened was, when the cars started stopping, Detroit got very concerned, and they sent cars down to the VOA facility. VOA Westchester was the only facility in the world that was, we took up a square mile, and it was the only facility that had roads on all four sides of the square mile. So they would send cars, and VOA would never broadcast, would never announce what the broadcast schedule was for security reasons and jamming reasons. So nobody knew which antenna was active when. So Detroit would send cars down, and they'd spend all day driving that square mile to see whether or not their cars would survive. But Mercedes-Benz eventually shipped cars over and drove around. We all understand this diagram very well, the shortwave propagation diagram. And that is how VOA pushed its signal from the United States into foreign targets. The advantage of shortwave is what we all understand today. However, we did not do long wave. When it got to the target location, many of the stations then pushed it out on medium wave or long wave. VOA had several long wave and medium wave stations. And that's for the reason I mentioned earlier. It's not dependent on the outer atmosphere, and you can push it out at daytime or nighttime. So this is kind of what it looked like during normal operations. We are pushing shortwave into a target location. They have the choice of pushing out in either a long wave, medium wave, or short wave. And some of the, many of the broadcasts were shortwave directly to a target, and people had shortwave receivers. So that's that went on very early with the WLWO, and then continued when the high power transmitters went on the air. And as I mentioned, it was that high ERP that caused Hitler to talk to his audience as the Cincinnati Liars. Let's switch gears here a little bit and talk about the building out of the Voice of America transmitting plant. When France fell, or when Pearl Harbor happened, that's when Roosevelt figured out that this country really needed to get into the broadcasting business. He called the broadcasters all back for a meeting, asked who could build a high power transmitter, and there was dead silence in the room. There was CBS, NBC, GE, Westinghouse, all the major broadcasters, including Crosley Broadcasting. Eventually, Crosley raised their hand, says, "Sir, we think we can do it." Well, they'd already done a 500,000 watt medium wave. The issue was short wave frequency. So Crosley came home with a contract to build six high power transmitters and 22 high efficiency antennas, 22 of the rhombic type antennas. And that's what it looked like. They started early in 1943, and the completion of the first 200 kilowatt transmitter actually went on the air for testing before the roof of the building was finished. The picture on your left is the Crosley built transmitter. The transmitter was designed and built in that building. Designed in the building, part of it was built in another building downtown. And this entire facility then tested out and proved the concept of this transmitter. Once all the design work was done, if you will, then they built other facilities. There was Delano, California, and Dixon, California, San Francisco and LA area. And then when Vietnam came along in the 60s, the government decided they needed more broadcasting power and build out Greenville, North Carolina. Bethany station here in Cincinnati took up a square mile. Greenville is the largest VOA station ever built. They took up 3 square miles. They had so many transmitters, they had 2 buildings, Site A and Site B. Site A is no longer functional, but Site B is functional. They're pushing out 6 shortwave signals, 3 into North Africa, 3 into Cuba, and occasionally on air with another one. So this is what the world looked like when VOA eventually got built out. There were 5 transmitting plants in the United States and 13 relay stations around the world, with a total of 133, a little bit over that actually, of high power transmitters. And when I say high power, I mean 250,000 watt, 500,000, or 1,000,000 watt transmitters. The operation of VOA in the United States was shortwave. It was 5 to 21 megahertz. We did not push out medium wave. And as I mentioned, once it got to a target location, they had the choice of how they were going to get to their audience, and they would choose shortwave, medium wave, or long wave. But we would have 6 transmitters on at the same time out of Bethany Station down here. And rather than, this map gets too messy if I put everything else on there, but when you've got 18 transmitting plants around the world, with 133 transmitters, you've got a lot of propagation going on. And so that's how it went about. VOA did something very special, and they did what is called barrage broadcasting. And when they decided to push a program message into a country, they would turn on a lot of the high power transmitters. They could turn on all the transmitters in the United States, point it to that country, and they would turn on some relay stations and point it to that country. They would be on different frequencies, like I said, anywhere from 5 to 21 megahertz, but it would be a massive effort to push that message into a target location. We did have trouble getting into Russia for shortwave, and in the off the island of Rhodes, Greece, the government put in a Coast Guard ship, Coast Guard cutter Courier, and it was a Coast Guard cutter because it's non-confrontational, as opposed to the Navy that has transmitters, but they're confrontational with guns. So the Coast Guard cutter was put in operation off the islands of Rhodes with a 150,000 watt transmitter, very effective in terms of pushing into Russia. We pushed out of Bethany, we pushed to the Coast Guard cutter the message, and then they rebroadcast it. Other stations also pushed into the Courier. This is what it looks like. The original antenna is the picture on the right. They put up a big balloon with a cable, and it was obviously a large vertical. And that was the original transmitting antenna. The 150,000 watt transmitter, actually they had 2 of them, would use that antenna. And it lasted for a while, but the cable kept breaking. It was, and when you see the size of that cable, it's just hard to imagine that you could break that cable. But they broke the steel, the wire rope often. What we're looking at here is a fix to that problem. Rather than use the balloon, they strung a wire between the 2 masts and loaded that up as the broadcast antenna. Where the picture where I got the circle that says the transmitters, they put in a couple of inverted deltas and also used that on the higher frequencies. They got the signal from the United States, all right? Well, if you've got a 150,000 watt transmitter at this end of the ship, and you're going to put a receiver at this end of the ship, you think it's going to work? No, it overloads the front end like crazy. So that what you're looking at the front end is an attempt to build a Faraday cage. It didn't work, and so eventually they put the receivers up on the island of Rhodes, put a VHF link into the ship, and then that worked very well. But this was very effective in getting into Russia. The interesting thing was there's three half-million watt generators in the hull of the ship. Obviously, they're going to use a lot of diesel fuel. When the ship needed to be refueled, an entire American fleet showed up. The carrier, all of its destroyers, air support, everybody's there to stick a gas hose in the courier. It was the biggest spectacle going on the island of Rhodes. Everybody showed up for the refueling of the courier.
What year was
that? Oh boy. That would have been, do you remember, 39, or not 39, around?
It was during Reagan's time.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Mark. I want to acknowledge we've got some VOA museum people here, Mark Havagas and Mike Braun, and obviously Jocelyn. Thank you.
I didn't hear the answer.
During Reagan's era, I'm sorry, yeah, during, I don't remember the year, but let's talk a little bit about how VOA operated on a daily basis. The audio program, the program content originated in New York, and the picture you're looking there on the left-hand lower side are the broadcast studios. It's just a plain room with acoustical tile on the wall and all the audio processing equipment. It went to a master control up in the top right and bottom right, and that pushed the audio out to all of the transmitting plants around the country. By phone lines. Originally, the audio came in on phone lines, eventually AT&T long lines, the microwave link, and then eventually by satellite. And that's how we got the audio here at Bethany. In the mid-1950s, the VOA moved from New York to Washington, D.C., and put in video. They still did, obviously, the radio broadcasting, but this is some of the studios active today. They have a huge YouTube presence, presence in audio. During the war, they translated English into 47 different languages, and you'll see here they're now translating into over 60 different languages and dialects. This is Bethany Station. That's us down here, and the reason I have this picture is to show the recording. We often would push out live as the audio came in. It'd go on a transmitter and go right back out. But there were several times that was not possible, so they would record the broadcasting. And the station had a series of lays to cut vinyl records. So you would make a record for rebroadcast a few hours later or maybe the next day. And the picture, these are the lays down here. Eventually, they started putting in reel-to-reel tape. Okay, let's talk about how did Hitler get control of his people. He had the only transmitter. He made the radios. It was pretty much a no-brainer. How does the United States get an audience? You put these high-power transmitters on the air. Who's listening? How do you get an audience? That was a big issue. Well, the United States had a secret weapon, and the secret weapon was the music of jazz. American jazz is unique. It represents America. It's free-flowing, and other countries tried to emulate it without a lot of success. Many countries outlawed listening to American jazz around the world. So what VOA did was they put on jazz and used Willis Conover as the coordinator, and they had the Conover Jazz Hour. Louis Armstrong, Fast Domino, et cetera, were all big performers. And that's one of the ways you instantly can get a large audience, as people were constantly tuning through shortwave bands because they knew that's how they got their information. As we move away from World War II and go all the way up through the Cold War, Voice of America became even more important. It was very strategic in getting information to the people, not that different than what's going on today with the conflict going on and trying to get accurate information to the countries involved. As I mentioned, the translation today is in over 60 different languages, and What we don't understand probably is there's a lot of words in other languages that just do not translate. Russia does not have the word the word science. Nigeria does not have the word helicopter, et cetera, et cetera. So VOA set out to solve that problem. They take the American dictionary, which has approximately 40,000 words in it, and skinned it down to just those words that accurately translate to all these different languages. And it turned out to be a dictionary of just 1,500 words. Originally, it was called Special English. Today, it's called Learning English. But all of the broadcasts and bulletins were done using Special English, and you could use only that dictionary. Those books are the dictionaries on Wikipedia, and all of the translation books are on Amazon. You can buy a translation book for Liberia into English on Amazon. And those are some of the books there. Also, the other way, didn't quite know this when they started, but the way you get a large audience is to talk about health. Most countries do not have good health information, and that turned out to be a very big benefit to the station, is to explain how to have a better water, better sanitation, and all of that. There's two websites active right now that you can get all of the broadcasts. One is called VOA News. The other is called Inside VOA. And they put on a program called This is America. And we all are so used to being in this country, we don't think about it. But they'll put on a program and they'll talk about food trucks or crayons or just things that are standard to us. But they're foreign countries don't have the word fast food, for example. So what is fast food? The tagline started right from the very beginning of not being a propaganda station. Roosevelt really, really wanted a propaganda station, but he hired the wrong people, and the people decided to tell the truth. Eventually, they got a propaganda station. We recognize it as Voice of Free Europe, Radio Free Europe. That's set up by the CIA and is truly a propaganda station, but VOA remained as a truthful station. And the tagline, Tell the Truth and Let the World Decide, was a tagline started right from the very beginning and continues today through the broadcast. The station was decommissioned in 1994, went off the air, as did the two California stations shortly thereafter, and went virtual. And as I mentioned at the beginning, everything you can get that VOA produces is available through these mechanisms. Let's talk about jamming a little bit, because that was a really big deal. Jamming VOA broadcast was very aggressive. Russia actually spent more money jamming than they did broadcasting. And they set up a technical institute called the Leningrad Communication Institute. Men were fighting, so it was staffed by women. And women got to be very, very good at this, of learning how to tune up and run the transmitters. And over the course of implementation, Russia put out over 1,500 jamming transmitters. Typically, they were low power. They had a few half million watt transmitters. But what they would do is they would circle a city. There would be a listener, and any foreign broadcast coming into that city, they would put a transmitter on to jam it. And that's how that's why the numbers are so high, is to have 1,500 transmitters throughout the country. And this would be an example. They would just circle a city with transmitters. The interesting thing is that if you did not live in a populated area, a populated city, you could probably pick up the broadcast, because their jamming is shortwave and it skips. And so there's a lot of the rural area to where you could pick up VOA rather easily. Here's an example of just Lithuania. They had a receive station that was about 15 miles from their transmitting station. And this lady sat there all day long, tuning around, looking for foreign broadcast. And when she found it, she would get a hold of this lady over at the transmitting plant, and she would tune up a transmitter and jam that that broadcast. That is not offensive. Those are buzzers. Those are all buzzer transmitters as we know them. But it was a very large operation that they did. China took an extremely interesting approach. They actually put together curtain antennas that were rotatable. They have 13 of them, and there was a 500,000-watt transmitter behind every curtain. And they did an outstanding job of pushing a signal around to jam incoming signals. Today, satellite jamming is a big deal because all of the information is pushed around by satellite. This is the Baghdad embassy, and you can see all the satellite antennas on the roof of the building. VOA Munich antenna, shortly after the United States could occupy Germany, they went into Europe and they built a shortwave transmitting plant, and they also built a high power long wave station. And this is the part of the antenna for the 1 megawatt. It's a 1 megawatt long wave station, and it uses a continental transmitter built on Texas. The United States is on 60 hertz. Europe is on 50 hertz. So what are you going to do? Well, you're going to have to generate 60 hertz. So on your far left-hand side is a huge diesel tank farm, a huge building to generate power, 60 hertz power, and then the cooling towers for the generators, and finally the actual transmitting plant to generate 1 megawatt on 173 kilohertz that they operated on. But this is just one transmitter of the 153, and it's a massive, massive build out here to transmit. And this is where what Joseph Goebbels did for Hitler when he made those radios on long wave, very effective. And it's kind of interesting when you have to get on a ladder to look at your antenna insulator like that. They had other megawatt stations around, medium wave. As we know, Crosley put 500,000 watts on here in 1934, and he could pretty much broadcast around the world, certainly all over the United States. And so VOA did not need a lot of medium wave or long waves as long as they had a megawatt behind it. The other issue, let's switch gears here again. Like I say, I want to kind of cover the overall operation. When we had to push, or we or any other station had to push shortwave into a country, and particularly South Africa, it's got a lot of width and a lot of depth. So you have a propagation issue as to, can you propagate all daytime here and there, all nighttime here and there? And what are you going to work when there's part day there and night here? So there was a large effort put together to figure out how to do propagation. I'm not going to dwell on it a lot, but there was a large staff at headquarters that did nothing but figure out propagation and told Bethany what antenna to be on, what frequency, and what time of day in order to be effective. They knew all of our antennas, they knew the directions, and so they could put together a program schedule to do that. Eventually, VOA wrote software for it, and that's what we all use in amateur. They donated it to amateur radio, and that's what we all use as the vocap software program today. That was a huge help to the agency. The station used a lot of power, about 4 megawatts, and during the war we had dual power feeds, one from Cincinnati, one from Dayton, had a tendency to brown out Mason, Ohio, tried to be good neighbors and not do that, and so they had the ability to have a dual power feed. After the war, the power company put in dual power feeds from two different power plants, so we could pull power from either power plant. Antenna field, this is a square mile that the station took up, and the red line represents that road that the cars would drive around. The white lines inside the red are the roads to the antennas, and those are the antennas. Those are the rhombics and their target location. For every target location, there were three Rhombics. So the Rhombics were three-wire Rhombics, fairly broadband, and there would be three of them that would cover 5 to 21 megahertz, 5 to just under 21 megahertz. And so that's how it was scattered throughout the property. In the mid-1950s, we put up those towers and put up two curtain antennas, and the curtain antennas had to be positioned. The beam is so narrow, it had to be positioned within a half a degree of a target location, and you could not buy a global map of the world accurate enough. So one of the engineers, bless his pea-picking heart, took a slide rule in 2 weeks and redrew the globe of the map and put Cincinnati in the center of it so he could accurately position the curtain antennas within a half a degree. And that's the map that he drew. That was the target locations. We had six major target locations, and the green lines are the feed lines. The feed lines to the back of the property were almost a mile long, and there were a feed line for each specific antenna. That's kind of a view in the mid-50s after the curtain antennas were put up. The interesting thing going on is when you have multiple antennas with 15 megawatts of RF coming off the end of them, you have a very high energy field. Consequently, you have to ground the building very well. The building has radials that go around the edge of it that go out 50 feet to provide a ground. The building was built with rebar, of course, and all the rebar was tack welded together. In the station, copper bar is laid in the floor, and everything in there is bolted to a copper bar. The windows have metal in the glass, and that's not to provide a shield. That's because with that high energy, glass is going to pick up a charge. The window frames are all grounded, and even the raised panel floors, each panel has a ground strap because you don't want to pick up a panel and have it get hot on you. So a lot of effort was put into grounding. The output of the transmitters was 300 ohms, and it's leaving the building here, a 300 ohm balanced line, and would then pushed out to the antennas on two different kinds of 300 ohm line, either wire antennas or copper pipe, 1-inch copper pipe, but it was set to be 300 ohm to the curtain antennas and 300 ohms to the switch, to the antenna switch. There was a 6 by 22 crossbar matrix switch that would take any of six high power transmitters and switch them to any of 22 antennas. That's what it looks like. That's the input to the switch with the six transmitters going in, and then the output, you could take it off either side of the switch up to 22 different antennas. That's the switch. It was a double pull, double throw switch, and there's 132 of those in that matrix, and they were manually driven with poles. You had to go out and pull the pole up and down. And that's what the operating poles looked like. That's a view of the switch and the antennas feeding out the sides of the switch. The matching, the 300 ohms went to the curtain antenna, and there was a matching transformer put at the base of the antenna to match it to the native impedance of the curtain, which was 62 ohms. The rhombics ran 560 ohm, so they matched the feed line. Right as soon as the feed line came out of the switch, they matched it right away to the rhombic, and then it was transmitted out at 560 ohm. We all enjoy directional couplers. We get to look at a little meter and figure out what the VSWR is. They did not have directional couplers in 1942-44, and so you literally had to walk the transmission line, and this is, I've got this set up in the museum. You can see it when you come down. It's literally a traveling voltmeter that you can walk down the line, look at the meter, and find the highs and the lows, and then go to a lookup chart and figure out what the VSWR is. But they literally, if there was ice on the transmission line, you had to knock the ice off the transmission line before you could measure VSWR. That's what the current meter looks like. Uh, The antennas were mounted on wood poles. This is kind of interesting. Did not have metal towers when these rhombics were built. And they used two 80-foot utility poles to make the support for the antenna. They're spliced together in the center with a metal splice. And so that gave you a 160-foot pole, 10 feet in the ground. So the rhombics were at 150 feet in height, and that's how they did it. The other issue going on in this environment is ice, as I mentioned, with ice in the switch and ice on all the wires. There was over 1,000 wood poles, and during ice storms, you had a lot of ice buildup. They would grease the fellow in the cart over there is greasing the cables. They would grease the cables to kind of minimize the ice buildup and also for longevity. So hope I'm within my time frame, but that kind of brings me to the end. Be happy to answer questions or if you got any. If not, yes, sir.
I visited the station a few years ago, and we had a very nice kind of talk-in on FM radio. What type of transmitter are you using for that?
We have an FM transmitter in the tower that gives you some of the time we're open and things like that. Is that what you're talking about? It's FCC compliant.
Yeah, he's talking about the transmitter in the tower, the
right.
FM that we broadcast.
Right, I know.
Okay.
That's FCC Part 15.
Yeah.
Right, whatever Part 15 is. Yeah. We actually get DX reports on that for some strange reason. We get a postcard from around the area. Hey, we heard your transmitter. Who knows? Yes, sir.
Did you ever have sabotage, like from foreign governments or spies?
We did not. The question was, did we ever have sabotage from foreign governments? Our understanding is we did not. The facility was highly secure. There was fence all the way around it. There were guards in the tower. And the only thing we ever figured out in terms of a break-in was somebody one Saturday night decided to cut the fence and come in. It was a local person who had nothing in foreign governments.
Over here. Yeah. During the Vietnam War, they used some of those transmitters for Armed Forces radio. Can you talk about that?
Please repeat the question.
Yeah, during the Vietnam War, those transmitters were also used for Armed Forces radio, shortwave broadcast in Southeast Asia. Can you talk about that?
Could you repeat the question for this?
Okay. The question was, were our transmitters used for other purposes like Armed Forces radio? Yes, they were. After the broadcast day ended, which was 12 to 14 hours, they would push out secret messages, coded messages. They would push out for Radio Marti and Armed Forces radio. They were multi-purpose, did not do a lot of that, but occasionally they did. Yeah.
Yeah, I know that during that period, get a lot of the baseball games that weren't covered otherwise in this area coming through on shortwave, particularly the West Coast games.
Yeah. Yeah, there was interstation transfers. We had six high power transmitters. We had 10 transmitters altogether. There were two 50 kW sideband units. There was a 10 kW double sideband unit, and we would push programs from to Delano or Dixon or Greenville or back and forth. Used a huge log periodic as our receive antenna, but we did. We pushed the programs around. By the way, just to be clear, I never worked for the Voice of America. I may sound like I did. I was an outside vendor. I called on them as precision test. I worked for General Radio Company out of Boston. They used our equipment to measure their antennas, but I was there as a vendor. I was never there as an employee.
How many of those radios are still intact,
the
transmitters?
The only transmitter is the one we salvaged. There's a complete Collins transmitter intact, most of it, that we've recovered, and we've opened it up inside, and you can come down and look all through it. I'd be happy to have you down. The PI line, the PI circuit is 36 feet long, and I can I'll go through and explain that to you if you'd like to. Other questions? Okay, well, thank you very much for the invitation to be here, and we appreciate the invitation.
Okay, thank you, Jocelyn and Leland. Maybe that gives everybody an incentive to go down to the museum and take a look. They've made a lot of improvements down there. There's a lot to see.